Welcome to Narc Abuse No More, where we're here to help educate you about narcissistic abuse, because your feelings do matter. Hi, welcome to another broadcast of Narc Abuse No More with your host, Dr. and Evangelist K.O. Rich. Thanks for tuning in today. Today is Monday, May the 16th of 2022. I pray that you've had a blessed, stress-free, narcissistic-free, abuse-free week so far, and that the remainder of this week will continue to be so as well. But if not, we're going to be talking about a few things today. Again, my name is Dr. K.O. Rich with Narc Abuse No More, where we're here to help you admit what you feel in order to heal from the effects of narcissistic abuse, because your feelings do matter. Yes, they do. But before we go on with today's broadcast, I would like to invite you to visit us on our website at www.narcabusenomore.org. Again, that website address is www.narcabusenomore.org. And on that website, you find valuable information regarding narcissism, regarding relationships. You can also listen to these broadcasts if you have missed any. Go on the website and listen to us from there. Or just to let you know, we're on every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday at 10 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, 9 a.m. Central on SoundCloud, iHeartRadio, Spotify, Spreaker, Google Play, iTunes, Deezer, CastBox. We're also on Amazon Audible, Rumble, and YouTube. So most of the people listen to us from Amazon Audible and iTunes, but you have a variety of different platforms that you can listen to us from. So make sure, let me just say this. If you are loving the information that you're getting, please take time to share. Take time to share these broadcasts with other people so that they can get the information that you are being privileged to 3 times a week. And another thing, if you're not able to tune in at the time that we air, you can always catch us in our archives. Regardless of whichever platform you're listening to us from, you can always catch us in the archives. So therefore, you do not have an excuse to miss one episode. All right, what are we talking about today? We're talking about evil people. Yes, there are some evil people. Can you believe the when you watch the news, there is so much drama, so much wickedness that's taking place. Over the weekend, 10 people got killed. I believe that was in a supermarket in, was it Boston? In Boston. Then a shooting in a church. And these things are happening all around this nation, where there's domestic violence, there's sex trafficking, there's so many different issues. And we talk about a lot of these things on my other broadcast of It Is Finished, End Times Ministries. However, I want to just read to you today just a little bit from 2 Timothy chapter 3, because as time go on, things are going to get worse. You say, how worse can it get? It can get even worse than what we're seeing right now. And you might say, well, I'm not a Bible believer. Well, let me just say this. There are prophecies in the Bible that is being fulfilled right now in real time. And I just want to read you all something from 2 Timothy chapter 3. And then we're going to talk about the signs of evil people, the things that you see, because when we're talking about narcissism, when we're talking about toxic relationships, we're talking about wickedness, evil. And so in 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 1, it says, but mark this, there will be terrible times in the last days. People will be lovers of themselves. Hint, hint, narcissist. People will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boastful, proud, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, without love, unforgiving, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, not lovers of the good, treacherous, rash, conceited, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying its power, have nothing to do with such people. That's right. See, these few verses right here that I just read, 2 Timothy 3 verses 1 through 5, sums it all up perfectly. And then Paul, who wrote this, said, hey, have nothing to do with such people. There was going to be terrible times. And we know that we're living in terrible times. Anytime you can go shoot innocent people who have done nothing to you, anytime you don't care about going into the house of God, shooting up someone, we're living in such times. And so I want to talk today about 20 things that evil people do and how to deal with them, because we are living in some difficult times. And as always, I love to give you where to get articles from, hackspirit.com, evil people, 20 things they do and how to deal with them. And we're going to talk about that today. And number one of the things that evil people do is they enjoy watching other people in pain. Now, most of us, we're empathetic to the pain of others. We don't want to see anyone in pain. When you see someone that's hurting right now, for example, I feel for the babies and the mothers who are experiencing a lack of formula. We know that there's a baby formula shortage. And so you empathize with those mothers that's searching to try to feed their children. You empathize with the babies who are in need of this milk in order to be able to grow, in order to be able to have their brain function and develop properly. This is important. And the things that's going on with this shortage right now is heartbreaking. So, but when you're dealing with the evil person, they don't feel for others. They don't empathize with others, and they actually enjoy watching the suffering of others. And that is something that is so evil, is diabolical for them to even exploit the pain of others, to gain pleasure from the pain of others. And when you have someone that is abusing you, they're enjoying your pain. I don't care how many sorries they come up with. Oh, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry. When you have these repeat offenders that keep abusing you, they're enjoying the suffering that you're going through. They are not empathetic. They're not feeling towards you. Number two, they need to control everything. We talk about narcissists and how manipulative they are. When you're dealing with evil people, period, they want to control you. They want to tell you how to think, what to say, what to do, when to do. They want to control every aspect of your life. We talk about, I'm not sure if we've mentioned on this broadcast, but when you talk about communism, when you talk about Marxists, when you talk about just wickedness, they want to control you, where you don't have any freedoms, where you don't have any liberties, where you don't have the freedom to think or to speak. And this is evil beyond measure. Number three, they manipulate everyone. They love to lie. They love to bend things to their will. They try to hurt people. They try to turn the negative attention away from themselves while they're controlling things in the background. You wonder why a lot of when people are talking about cleaning things up, when you wonder why things cannot get cleaned up, it's because those that are manipulating the process are in the background. They're behind the scenes manipulating the strings. And this is how evil people operate. Number four, they hide their true selves. We talk about on this broadcast, and when you're dealing with narcissists, and they wear this mask, and you don't see the true essence of who they are because they're well disguised. And this is what evil people do. They disguise themselves. So when we talk about evil, think back to the Garden of Eden. For those who know the story of Genesis, the Garden of Eden, and how Satan entered the snake. He didn't come as his true self. He entered the snake in order to be able to deceive Eve, and she allowed herself to be deceived, and then we know the story from there. They hide who they really are. Number five, they leave you with a weird feeling whenever you are around them. This is why it's so important to have spiritual discernment. Because when you are around someone, or you is someone that doesn't mean you any good, well, guess what? If you have that spiritual discernment that only comes from God, you will be alerted as to this person is not right. You won't feel good around them. You might be questioning things. You might be paying extra attention to things. Your spiritual discernment clock, or alarm, should I say, is constantly going off saying, beware, beware, this person does not mean you any good. Number six, they show no remorse. You talk about those that are unempathetic towards people. They don't feel sorry when they do things to you. Rather than take responsibility, they'll shift the blame or make you feel as if it's you. They'll gaslight you. They will not ever admit to anything that they do wrong. They show no remorse for things that they do. Have you ever seen when you see a serial killer and they're in the courtroom, no emotions or whatever? This is how evil people operate. They won't have any remorse for the things that they do. And you wonder, how in the world could they not feel for what they have done to their victims? But the thing is, if you had any feeling at all, you wouldn't have done it to begin with. So when you have serial killers, like, you know, when you had Ted Bundy and different ones that were serial killers, Jeffrey Dahmer, different ones that were still serial killers, they had no remorse for the things that they had done. Number seven, they are mean to other people. And this starts off even as children. You see the bullies and how mean they are. And even if they make one of the other children cry, they get off on it. And that gives them just enough juice to keep it going again and again and again until someone finally stands up to them. They are very mean to other people. They don't care about your feelings. They take joy in hurting others. They take joy in stabbing others in the back. They are people that you can never trust because they are very diabolical. They're very wicked. They're very evil. Number eight, again, they don't take responsibility for their actions. They're going to blame somebody else. They're going to try to gaslight you, make you doubt your reality. The evil people get off on never taking responsibility for anything. You know what the thing is? It makes me think about the court system, our legal system. Now, everybody's entitled to a fair trial, and everybody's entitled to an attorney. But when you have someone that know that they did the crime, such as killing someone, and then they have the nerve to plead not guilty. I mean, so that's a prime example of not taking responsibility for their actions. Now, our legal system allows you to be able to plead whatever you want. But it's just the thought of you knew you did this crime against this individual, and then you have the nerve to plead not guilty. All right, we're going to take a quick break, and we'll be back in just a moment.
fighting voices in my mind that say I'm not enough. Every single lie that tells me I will never measure up. Just the sum of every high and every low. Remind me once again just who I am, because I need to know. Oh.
Still talking on evil people, just the thought of just people not caring. And again, this was foretold in the Word of God that we will be living in such times that people would not care what they do to others. Number nine, they come with a reputation. Normally when you're dealing with someone that's evil, it doesn't just stop with one person. it continues on. You have a path, a history of it. They have a reputation of doing evil things to people. Now, when you're dealing with narcissists, they try to cover it up and they try to camouflage, where people only see certain aspects of who they are and they don't see what they don't want others to see. But when you're dealing with someone that's really evil, a lot of times when you're dealing with people that commit crimes, for example, they will often have a history of doing it. They've been in trouble with the law before, and it's progressed over the years. Different little petty crimes, and then it graduated to larger things. Number 10, they only come around when they need something. You have evil people that don't care about you, only what they can get from you. So therefore, you will find that they only come around if they have a hand, their hands out. They want something that they want you to do for them. And this is using people. Most people, they don't want to use other people. If they need something, it's a mutual thing that, hey, I'll give it back to you. And a lot of times when you're dealing with evil people, they'll try to wiggle their way out of even giving it back if you give them a loan. However, when you're dealing with someone that is not of that mindset, they don't want to use other people. They want to contribute to society, not just take away and use others at their expense. Number 11, they laugh at the misfortune of others. We should never take joy when other people fall. And you have evil people that do that. They take joy when something happens to others. If someone loses their job, they're happy. If someone loses their home, they're happy. If someone gets a bad diagnosis for their health, they're happy. They take joy in it. And so that is not something that we as people want to do to others. Number 12, you get a strange vibe from them. We all have something that God places on the inside of us to let us know, alert, alarm. And when we pray and ask God for spiritual discernment, He will let you know that, hey, something's not right with this particular individual. And He will sometimes let you know through dreams and visions. He will give you a sense on the inside of you to let you know that, hey, something is not right. It doesn't feel right. So never ignore whatever it is, your gut feeling, whatever you want to call it, that's on the inside of you. I choose to call it the Holy Spirit, who has given me spiritual discernment to let me know if something is not right. Number 13, they are mean to animals. You can tell a lot about people sometimes by the way that they are with animals. Now, if they treat animals wrong, then you can count that they're going to treat you wrong. I truly believe when people don't like animals I believe it's something, it could be something from their background that may have caused them not to like animals. But even if you don't like animals but you choose to be mean to them, then that says something about that individual. Now, I'm a pet lover. I'm an avid pet lover. And if I see someone that mistreats animals, that's going to let me know that I need to stay away from you. Also, animals have a sense of discernment. If you have an animal and they really don't like a particular individual. Now, I have a German Shepherd, and my German Shepherd doesn't want anyone on her territory. She considers the whole neighborhood her territory. But she especially does not want anyone to come up in my house, on the yard, at the mailbox. She is very territorial. So the thing is that anybody that comes this way, she's like, back up. This, you do not belong here. All right. But sometimes animals, you get, even cats, they get a sense that this person is not right. And if they're running for the hills, you may want to actually think about that person that you are around. And you don't want to be mean to animals. You don't want to be mean to children. You don't want to be mean to elderly. And let me just say this too. notice how people act when, for example, you go to a restaurant. And if that person is snotty with the waiter or the waitress, then that lets you know about their personality, that they think that they're better than other people. And let me just say this, you're no better than anyone else because, hey, they are working to help serve you. And how is it that we can feel, and when I say we, that just as people, period, that we can feel that we're better than anyone. None of us is better than anyone. Some of these waiters or waitresses are working their way through school. They may have a better job than you have at the end of the day. So we want to always make sure that we are kind and loving to everyone. Number 14, they think it's funny when they insult you. Now, when you're dealing with evil people, they're never taking your feelings into consideration. They actually get a kick out of hurting you. This is why they're evil, all right? They don't care about what they do to others. They get a kick out of it. If someone gets a kick out of insulting you and hurting you and they know that they've hurt you, then something is wrong with that individual, all right? You need to rethink the relationship that you may have with this person. Number 15, evil people lie a lot. They're dishonest, all right? They don't care about the truth. Jesus told the religious leaders that they were of their father, the devil, and there was no truth in him from the very beginning, all right? And so these people or evil when they can't tell the truth to save their life. Or, and you see a lot of this in society where people just blatantly lie. Okay, blatantly lie. You see it all over mainstream media and the government, all kinds of things that's going on. Lies on top of lies on top of lies. Okay, so these are evil people. One of the things that God has said is that all liars will have their part in the lake of fire. Number 16, evil people manipulate everything and everyone. Again, when you're dealing with evil people, they want to use you. They want to abuse you. They want to cast you aside. They want to make you feel as if you're worth nothing, that you're worth less. They want to diminish your self-esteem. They don't care about your feelings at all. They don't even take you into consideration, okay? When you're dealing with evil people, you're dealing with people that don't care about you. Sad. But true. Number 17, they make people feel stupid. Yes, they want to make sure that they make themselves feel good at your expense because they don't care anything about you. These are toxic individuals, all right? So then when you're dealing with people like this, you don't share your dreams. You don't share your visions. They may even steal it from you and put their name on it, all right? Because they don't want you to succeed. They are very abusive and they will drain the life force out of you. Number 18. They don't know what guilt is. They don't know what guilt is because they don't feel bad for their actions. They don't apologize in the true essence of the word. They never feel sorry. They may even make promises that, oh, they'll never do it again. But as we know, and we often talk about, abuse is a vicious cycle. It goes around and around and around until it actually wears the victim out. You know, we're dealing with some serious times right now where people just don't care, and which leads us into 19. Evil people don't get it. They don't get it. They're so toxic, they can't feel empathy. They don't put themselves in other people's shoes. They don't understand the misery that they cause others. They don't care to put themselves in other people's shoes to understand the misery that they are causing others. And number 20, Everything is about them. They manipulate, they lie, they will lie. They don't care about how it affects other people. If they want something, they're gonna move whatever they can and whoever they can to get to what they want. They don't care how it affects the other person. And that's when you're in the company of evil people, this is what you can expect. Now, we're going to take another quick break, and we'll be back in just a moment. Ooh,
yeah. Lost touch with my soul. I had nowhere to turn. I had nowhere to go. Lost sight of my dream. Thought it would be the end of me. I thought I'd never make it through. I had no hope to hold on to. I thought I would break. I didn't know my own strength, and I crashed down and I tumbled, but I did not. My darkest hour, my faith kept me alive. I picked myself back up, hold my head up high. I was not built to break. I didn't know my own strength. Oh. Found hope in my heart. I found the light to light my way out of the dark. Found all that I.
I didn't know my own strength, and that is by the late Whitney Houston. So how do we deal with angry people? Well, sometimes your dealing is getting angry about it. Now, this is not in the wrong way. This is not going and causing any harm for anyone else. But this is saying that, hey, I am tired of dealing with these types of people. I am tired of the lack of empathy. I'm tired of the abuse. Yes, I am angry about it, but in a righteous anger. Okay, we're not talking about going and doing any harm to anyone, because then what sets you apart from that other person? All right, but you have to say, okay, I am angry about what's happening to me. I'm acknowledging my feelings. I'm embracing my feelings that I don't like what was done to me. And so therefore, there needs to be a change. One of the things that you can do to change that situation is by setting limits. You don't need to be up under the pressure of this person. You avoid being up under that pressure by setting limits and distancing yourself if and when necessary. You don't have to subject yourself to their wickedness, to their abuse. Start taking care of you and do things that will help you to be happy, to bring about peace in your life. And that's when you get true empowerment, by not allowing others to take away your peace, your happiness, your sense of serenity. Number three, don't die in the fight. Sometimes we can just let people get so into our heads that it causes us to die spiritually. Our physical body start dying in a sense of stress and high blood pressure and anxiety and panic. And you don't want to die in the fight, all right? So you have to relax. You need to stay calm and be mindful that you are being responsive, not reacting, but responsive, okay? That means that I'm responding to the situation with my head being clear. I'm not reacting out of my emotions. Sometimes you have to take a break and just say, walk away and just say, you know what, I'll revisit this at a later time when I have had the time to clear my head and think accordingly. Number four, rise above and don't get sucked into their web. They love to keep you off balance, these evil, wicked people. So they can drive you insane if you allow them to. So when you know what the triggers are, you know what you're looking for, you know what the signs are, don't get sucked in. This is why we have to think with our heads and not our emotions. Don't respond. Don't give them an emotional response. Okay, a reaction more say. Respond with a clear head. Whatever you need to do for setting boundaries, saying no, not allowing them to get you drugged into their situation. Number five, stay aware of your emotions. If you know that you're getting upset, if you know that you're getting angry, out of control, be on top of your emotions. Pull back, press the pause button. If you know that, hey, this is not going to end well because I'm all up in my emotions at this time. Number six, establish boundaries. One of the things that we talk about when you're dealing with narcissistic individuals is they don't like boundaries. They don't want you to tell them no. They don't want to adhere to boundaries when you say, okay, this is the line that you will not cross under no circumstances. They don't want to adhere to that. However, you have the right to establish your boundaries and stick to them. Number seven, don't let anyone limit your joy. One thing that evil people want to do is they want to cause chaos in your life. They want to take away your joy. They're not happy themselves. They're miserable individuals, and so they want to make you miserable as well, because misery loves company. Do not let anyone take away your joy. If you know that someone is coming to cause you drama and stress, then you can stop it at the door. Do not allow anything that interrupts your peace, your joy, your happiness. Don't allow them even into your mind, into your thoughts, into your heart, into your home. Stop them at the door and let them know this is not taking place today. Number eight, focus on solutions and not problems. We can tend to think about a lot of problems, but we also need to focus on solutions to those problems. Because if you don't focus on the solution, it's only going to just be a problem. But when we focus on the solution to the problem, then you're actually going somewhere and you can get a lot more done with focusing on the solution. And one thing is, as we wrap this up today, is there's never going to be peace on this world until the Prince of Peace come back. And that's Jesus. Therefore, we can only manage and control what we're able to handle ourselves. We can't control anyone else. We cannot control the world. We can pray about it, which is our most important weapon as Christians, is prayer. But we cannot control what other people do. We can only be an example. We can only share with them the goodness of Jesus, but we cannot control evil people. However, we can ensure that they do not harm us as much as possible. Now, these people who were the unfortunate victims of these evil people over the weekend, they didn't know that it was going to be their last day. They didn't know that they were not going to live to see Monday. They did not know that the evil that took place was going to happen to them. We can walk out of here on any given day and someone can just do something wicked, and that'd be the last day that we're alive. However, if it's at all possible, and this is what the Apostle Paul said, if at all possible, be at peace with all men, as much as possible, as it's on you to do. But you can't control what other people do. However, you can ensure that you try to get as much peace as possible. And if you can set boundaries and things that will help you to get peace, then by all means, do so. All right, we are about it here. I pray that today's broadcast has been a blessing to you. And we look forward to seeing you on the next broadcast, where we're here to help you admit what you feel in order to heal from the effects of narcissistic abuse, because your feelings do matter. This is Dr. K.L. Rich. Until next time. Thank you.